grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Our text for our message this morning is our Old Testament lesson, which we heard read a moment ago. Dear friends in Christ, as you are all aware nowadays, Samuel is on the move. Our son loves to explore, crawling from one piece of furniture to the next, picking up a toy, looking at it, turning it over, and of course chewing on it. But then I'll put it down and move on to something else. Yes, he's crawling incredibly fast nowadays, and very soon he will be walking, something that we're very excited about, but something that also, of course, makes us a little bit uneasy. Because in his exploring, Sam sometimes likes to wander to places that, you know, he's not supposed to go. And so we'll be sitting in our living room watching TV, and then Sam will, you know, he'll be content for a while, but then he'll think, I've had enough of this, it's time to go explore somewhere else. And so he'll start to go through the kitchen or start to go down the hallway. And then one of us will say, Sam, where are you going? And he'll pause and he'll turn and look at us. Don't think they want me to go over here. And sometimes he gets that, actually. He'll turn around and come and just keep playing and doing what he likes to do. But other times, he doesn't. He'll turn and look at, Mom, Dad, I heard you, but I'm going to go over here now. I acknowledge you and what you said, but it's okay. I'm just going to go over here. It's fine. No big deal. Thanks for your concern. And so there he goes. Full steam ahead down the hallway or off into the kitchen to explore new things. Nothing can stop him until Mom or Dad comes and scoops him up. Hey, Sam, let's go back to the living room. And sometimes he's like, yeah, okay, that's fine. I still got some cool toys over in there. But other times, it's not exactly what he wants. And so there's a little bit of kicking and screaming being brought to a place that he doesn't want to go to. Friends, the image of a child kicking and screaming, that's the text of Jonah in a nutshell, isn't it? Our lesson today focused actually on Jonah's call of repentance to the people of Nineveh, but it's important for us to understand the whole story here. Do you remember how this story goes? It starts off with the Lord coming to Jonah and saying, go to the people of Nineveh because they are being incredibly evil and they need to be called out against. So in other words, God wants Jonah to go to preach repentance and judgment upon Nineveh so that they can turn from their evil ways. But is this what Jonah does? Nope, not at all. One-way ticket to Tarshish, please. Now, we have to back up just for a moment and remember, you know, where are these two places? Where is Nineveh and where is Tarshish? Well, you see, Nineveh, in relationship to Israel, is over to the east, over in what would have been at the time modern-day Assyria and what we would see as Iran. But Tarshish, we're not exactly sure where Tarshish was. There were a couple locations it could have been. It could have been to the north that Jonah would have traveled by sea in the area of Asia Minor, what is now modern-day Turkey. Or the other location is way across the Mediterranean over, actually, in modern-day Spain. So go east or go west. Jonah, regardless of which way he goes, he's not going to where God wants him to go. He's going the complete opposite direction. And so Jonah, then he goes to Joppa, which is a city on the coast of the Mediterranean. He finds a ship, pays the fare, and hops on. Things seem to be going okay so far with this whole ignoring God thing. But it doesn't take very long for that to change. You see, the Lord sends a strong east wind onto the Mediterranean Sea, and the waves start to become so tough that the ship threatens to break up. And the mariners are afraid, and they're crying out to their respective gods so that somebody might hear them and save their ship. And they even are throwing cargo overboard to try to lighten the ship. Meanwhile, what is Jonah doing in this story? He's actually fast asleep down in the middle, in the inner part of the boat. And the captain of the ship comes to him and says, get up and call out to your God so that we may not perish. So he goes against Jonah because back up top, nothing seems to be working. In fact, the sea is getting worse. So the mariners decide to cast lots to try to figure out who is to blame for this evil storm, and the lots fall to Jonah. He tells them that he's a Hebrew and that he's fearing the Lord who made the heavens and who made the sea and the land, and they realize this is why we're having this storm, because he isn't doing what he's supposed to do. Jonah is fleeing from his God. So they ask him point blank, what should we do so that we can get out of this storm? And Jonah actually is actually somewhat admirable in this. He says, you know, throw me overboard and the storm will cease. That's exactly what they do. They throw him overboard and it ceases, the storm ceases, the winds and the waves all calm down. And the amazing thing about this story is that in chapter 1, verse 16, is it said that these men, these mariners, who were calling out to all kinds of different gods, then feared God, the God that we believe in. Even through this tumultuous time, the Lord worked through the story of Jonah to bring even these men to faith in him. Now we know that, of course, the story of Jonah doesn't end with Jonah just plunging into the deep and drowning. Well, that's not the end of the story, because as he often does, the Lord works in very mysterious ways. And in chapter 2, that's exactly what he does once again. He appoints a great fish to swallow Jonah. And we don't know exactly what fish this was. And many today actually believe that it was likely a whale, but we don't know. Now, and remember, at this time, people wouldn't have made the distinction between fish and whale like we do in modern-day times. They just kind of generalized based on where those creatures lived, in the sea or in the land or wherever it was that they lived. But again, regardless of what specifically this great fish was, this is still a miracle of God preserving Jonah's life. And after the fish vomits him out on dry land at the command of the Lord, we had just seen him pray that we spoke in our intro before. And now, after he's up on dry land, once again, it's time for take two. Where are you going to go, Jonah? Well, this time, you're going to go to Nineveh, says the Lord, and you're going to call out against the people, the message that I tell you. And sure enough, this time, Jonah listens. He goes and he walks into the heart of this great city of Nineveh, and he gives them the message, yet 40 days, and Nineveh shall be overthrown. And I think much to his surprise, the people believe him. They listen, they fast and put on sackcloth. The king himself of Nineveh even issues a proclamation and says, you know, everybody, you know, listen to God, turn from your evil ways. And at the end of his proclamation, the king of Nineveh even says, who knows, that God may turn and relent and turn from his fierce anger so that we may not perish. And again, as we heard in the story, that's exactly what God does. He relents of the disaster he said he would do to the people of Nineveh. He doesn't do it. And so at this point, as 21st century Christians, as we're looking at this, we're kind of thinking, hey, Jonah, look, this must be great, man. You know, you preached repentance and people turned from their ways and they came back to believing in God. This is great. What do you think? Aren't you thrilled? Chapter 4, verse 1. But it displeased Jonah exceedingly. You know, and the Hebrew literally reads, it was exceedingly evil to Jonah that this happened. It was evil to Jonah that God spared Nineveh. Well, he knows that God would be gracious to them, and if they repented, he would be gracious. And Jonah didn't want that. Why didn't he want that? Because you see, Nineveh was in Assyria, and Assyria was an enemy of Israel. Why would you want your enemy to be spared? And that way, Jonah's actions make a little bit more sense to us. Why would God do something like that? That's who God is. God is love. God is so incredibly gracious. And in this story, with both the mariners who turned to the Lord in the boat and the people of Nineveh, some 120,000 people who repented, God shows us once again that the message of salvation is for all people, for the Gentiles, even you and me. You know, we can be like Jonah too, can't we? God was so incredibly gracious to Jonah, and he's been so incredibly gracious to us on a regular basis. But so often, we don't want to share that grace with others. We don't want to call other people to repentance and encourage them that God wants to have a strong relationship with them. And really, I think there are several reasons as to why we do this, as the devil seeks to use our sinful nature against us and against the kingdom of God. One reason, actually excuse is probably the better word, and one excuse is that we just simply don't want to rock the boat. We don't want to rock the boat when it comes to our friends and families or co-workers. We don't want to rock the boat with them because we're afraid of what they're going to think. Are they going to be upset with us? Are they not going to talk with us anymore? Whether it's family or friends, if they are Christian or if they are even not a Christian, if they're living contrary to God's word, we simply don't want to tell them to turn back to God because we're afraid of what might happen. Afraid it'll cause a rift, afraid they won't talk to us anymore. And so we simply don't do it. We avoid it like Jonah. A second excuse could be thinking, well, it's not my job to do that anyway. After all, don't we have a pastor to do that? The pastor's supposed to go out and do all that stuff. Well, it is true that it is my job as a shepherd of the congregation, of this congregation here at Holy Cross, to care for all of you and also to help us reach out to the community. The Lord still calls all of us as Christians to reach out, to call each other to repentance, to even call those out in our community to believe in Him as well. A third excuse that we come up with is, well, God really doesn't want us to be dealing with those people. You know, it sounds so mysterious, doesn't it? God doesn't want us to be dealing with those people out there in St. Genevieve who don't know the love of Jesus for them. And yet the number and the mystery of the people who are just out there who don't believe, that can be intimidating to us. That can make us afraid as well. So we avoid it like Jonah. And a final excuse that we might make is that thinking that, you know, doing this is just a waste of time to try to tell somebody about Jesus or call them to repentance. Because after all, I've told them once, I've told them twice, I've told them three times. What is a fourth time going to do in terms of bringing somebody back? It's not going to make a difference. I just know it. And so we avoid it like Jonah. Dear friends, all of these excuses happen because of what I would like to call the silo effect. We're all familiar with silos here in St. Genevieve as farmers where they store different crops. But really, we can tend to view our lives as silos, can't we? We have our church life on Sunday morning, our Christian silo, and then we have our work silo and our family silo, and we have our vacation silo and so on and so forth. And so often we segregate our lives. We segregate them and separate them into different categories, and we just see our Christian lives as one of those many categories. And when we see our lives just as like that, it's all too easy to make excuses to avoid proclaiming God's message, just like Jonah. But friends, that's the difference between us and Jonah and Jesus. Consider our excuses and Jesus' response. While we're so often afraid to rock the boat, that's exactly what Jesus does. He turned the Jewish leaders on their heads with his message and teachings of grace. When it came to saving the world, Jesus didn't say, it's not my job, but Father, thy will be done. Jesus didn't look at us and say, oh, those people. Rather, he came and said, I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. Jesus didn't see us as a waste of time. For Paul writes in Galatians 4, when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his Son, born of woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law. And in Romans 5, we hear this, for while we were still weak at when? Just the right time, God sent Jesus Christ who died for the ungodly. But he didn't stay dead, as we know. Jesus himself said that just as Jonah was in the belly of the fish for 3 days, so the Son of Man will be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. The men of Nineveh will rise up at the judgment with this generation and condemn it, for they repented at the preaching of repentance of Jonah. And behold, something greater than Jonah is here. In Jesus' death, God's wrath is poured out on him, and in his rising, our peace with God is complete. Just as God spared his wrath on the people of Nineveh, who were enemies of Israel, so he has spared his wrath on us, who were once enemies, but we are now at peace with God. Dear friends, we began our message today by asking, where are you going? And I, of course, know full well that Samuel later is probably going to try to go all over the place. Yet again, I know it'll happen. And we saw Jonah flee from God. But despite that, God brought him back and used him to preach repentance to the people of Nineveh, even though he did so reluctantly. We found that we can be like Jonah too, making our own excuses, and those excuses are symptoms of the silo effect, of going and looking at our lives as separate categories instead of seeing them as a whole. And then we saw Jesus, who doesn't give excuses, but produces results on our behalf for our salvation, so that we can have peace with God, our Father. So what does this mean as we now go out and live our daily lives as Christians? It means that we simply don't view our lives as silos, as separate categories, but rather see it as one big connected wheel with different spokes. We have the spokes of our lives, of work, of family, and friends, and vocations, this, that, and the other thing. But at the center of it all is Jesus. Jesus goes with us wherever we go as we seek to bring peace and love and mercy of God and all the relationships we interact with on a regular basis. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Now may the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, guard and keep your hearts and minds in this Christ Jesus to life eternal. Amen. Come up, Caroline, it's okay. You know? Okay. Good. All right. How are you guys doing this morning? Good? Good. I have a question for you. Have you guys ever played the game hide and seek? Is that a fun game to play? If somebody counts to like 10 or something like that, puts their hands in front of their head, and then you guys will go and you hide somewhere? Now, I would say that we could play a game of hide and seek now, but that might take too long. I think you guys could find some really good hiding spots, and I don't know if I'd be able to find them. I think it could take quite a while if we played the game of hide and seek. Right, Sam? Yeah, I think it would take a while too. So today in our lesson, Jonah actually was kind of playing a game of hide and seek. At least at first he was. He didn't want God to find him. He wanted to try to go so far away from God, he tried to hide from God. But then God said, Jonah, we're going to take you from over here, and we're going to put you back over here. And so that Jonah could do what he needed to do. Come here, Sam. So that's what he did, and God used Jonah to be able to preach the good news to the people of Nineveh so that then they believed in God. And that was a very good thing for them to be able to believe in God. Even though Jonah didn't want to preach God's word, he was able to do it, and the people repented and believed in God, which was a wonderful thing. Now similarly, we sometimes run away from God too, but does God still invite us back? Does he still love us? Yeah, he does. He still loves us, and he always kind of tries to find us, and he does find us. He's saved us through the waters of baptism. He's connected us to Jesus. And because of that, we who were once lost are now found. And we have that beautiful, beautiful reality that we get to believe in Jesus. So why don't we pray? Heavenly Father, thank you so much for all your love that you've blessed us with. Thank you that you have found us, that we are your children, and that we get to be with you because of Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen.